Whoa. Awesome. Awesome. Hey, this is John Bolger with Premier Guitar. I'm here with Vernon Reid of Living Color shortly before their gig in Nashville, Tennessee. Vernon, thank you so much for joining
me.
Oh,
man, thank you for having me.
Man, that was awesome.
Oh, well, you know, have my moments.
Hey, tell me about this guitar.
This is an S2 Vela custom, and basically this is a, like sort of the first in a line of guitars. I've been doing a thing with PRS, and I've known Paul for a very long time, so it's sort of the first time he's actually built a guitar for me.
Awesome.
And I really love it. It's based on their S2 Vela, but when I saw the body shape, I fell in love with it, and the first thing I asked was, is it possible to put a Floyd on it? And they're like, well, we don't really do Floyds on those guitars, but then, you know, I started torturing Rich Hannon, you know, and then he got with the guys in the shop and they worked it out. And also, this guitar is a V-shaped neck, and the thing about it is that Paul actually took the prototype and shaped the neck himself.
Oh, wow.
Which is really...
I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah, not at all.
It started out with these... it started out really with these custom 24s. He sent me a custom 24. This is a lovely guitar, but I'm a 22 fret guy. But he did a V-neck. He reshaped this to be a V-shaped profile. And that's kind of been my thing, really, with all the various guitars I've used.
Yeah, because you used to be an
From
ESP guy.
ESP, Hamer, and Parker.
Sure.
You know, and that was all based on a 63 Strat I played at 48th Street and had an extreme V-shaped neck.
Oh.
And I kind of fell in love with that shape.
Do you still have
that?
It
has
old
nothing
Strat
to do with my first initial.
Right. Do you still have that old Strat?
Oh, man, that 63, that was in before the days of salad. I couldn't, you know, no. But it lives in my memory, though.
That's
a cool thing. But that really inspired it. I actually tried playing Flying V's, and that was a total disaster. Total disaster. But anyway.
So this is kind of an amalgam of different things that you like that Paul put together for you?
Absolutely.
Well, man, like, as a master builder, how great that he actually shaped it.
You know, it's really generous of him, and he's just a positive person.
Yeah.
You know, and also he built, like, my mentor, Carlos Santana's,
right.
You know, that was the first time I got exposed to PRS.
Right.
Was seeing, like, one of my guitar heroes actually playing that guitar. Because I remember when when Carlos used to play the SG, then he had an L6S.
Right.
Then he played a Yamaha guitar, and then he started playing the Paul Reed Smith guitars. And that became his signature instrument. And also Jerry Garcia played Paul Reed Smith, you know,
right.
And a few other folks started getting into it. And, you know, but he didn't really do, because I was kind of getting into dive bombing and stuff like that, and really that wasn't their thing.
Right.
So I went with ESP, which is great, and then with Hamer, and they built some wonderful guitars. But eventually, you know, it came around to this. So it's very cool, because he's been supportive of the band and just been very cool for years.
Yeah, that's great. So tell me about some of the bells and whistles aside.
Okay, so this has locking trim. This also has a hex pickup, a Roland hex pickup system.
Oh, great.
You know, and like I said, the V-shaped neck.
And you're running EMG pickups?
EMGs, yes.
That's always been your thing, right?
For a long time. EMGs and actually EMGs, some Seymour Duncans, but EMGs, I had some DiMarzios in my early ESPs, but then also Tom Anderson.
Right.
Like Tom, you know, he's known for building his guitars, but he's a great pickup builder.
Oh, really?
So he, you know, did a bunch of pickups for me.
Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. So EMGs.
EMGs, I like EMGs.
Yeah. And then what else we got on control wise?
This is a volume, this is a tone, and this is a volume for the hex pickup.
Oh, cool.
This switch is only magnetic, a mix of magnetic and hex only.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So this tech's been around for a while, but there are other, interestingly enough, the whole pitch to MIDI guitar modeling thing has been evolving really rapidly.
Right.
You know, and so I've been experimenting with some of the Fishman stuff,
yeah,
like the triple play, which is amazing.
I mean,
really, in terms of pitch to MIDI, especially if you're working with soft synths, it's pretty remarkable.
Right, and just instantaneous.
Yeah, yeah. And Sonus, the company Sonus, they're a UK company, and they make this thing called the G2M, and it's you could put straight quarter-inch cable. It's got MIDI out. I actually have one of those boxes here, and for monophonic tracking, it's really good.
Right, right.
So I'm messing with all this stuff.
And what are those two mystery buttons on there?
Oh, these basically allow you to, if you set it, you could have it to do program change up and down.
Really?
Or you can set it to do pickup change, virtual pickup changing. You can basically program it to do a number. You could have it turn on a chorus or what have you.
Right. Wow. Fabulous. So for this tour, you're pretty much, this is your number one, and the custom is your number two.
Custom 24 is my number two.
Wow. And this, I like that you, did you have leave no finish on the back?
No finish on the back.
I love this one.
And it's a lovely oil finish.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah.
And like I said, Paul shaped these himself.
Yeah, you know, they do have a V to it.
Yeah, like, they were very extreme. Yeah, the thing about the V, the neck shape, is that it makes it really compulsively playable. Hmm. Because your thumb, when your thumb hits that peak, it really is a good position for the hand.
Right. It's almost like a classical kind of positioning, right?
Yeah. So generally when people pick the guitar up, they go, oh man, you know, like people haven't really messed with this neck shape.
Yeah.
When they sit with it for a while, they really like it.
Yeah. That's great. That's great. Well, they're beautiful, man. What?
Yeah, it's a lovely instrument.
Yeah, fantastic. All right. Well, that's awesome. Can we talk about your amps?
Yeah, man. I'm a boogie dude.
Right.
And this is two duals. This is this is an old early 90s recto. This is like the first head. They sent me, this is a tremolo verb, and basically they're both powering two recto caps.
Are you running stereo between them or switching?
Stereo. Yeah, they're running stereo, this one feeds this cabinet, this one feeds that one.
Yeah, because out front you could hear a real stereo spread that was, it's got to be pretty awesome to have that behind you just panning and spreading like that. It's
and kind of what's in, the other thing I'm doing is I'm using I'm running a VG99. This is like an old bit of gear, but I'm also running a Kemper profiling amp.
Oh wow!
And I've been doing this thing with these splitting molting mixers. They're these little mixers. I found them, DOD makes them.
Huh.
And they're pretty versatile because they're mono, they're four in and one out, or they're one in and four out. So they serve as, you can mix a signal, but you could also molt a signal.
Oh.
And so that's part of the thing. Like a lot of what I'm doing is parallel processing. It's not in series at all. So essentially I'm sending guitar, the magnetic pickups are coming from the guitar out, and using these kind of mono splitters, it's like one in, four out, I'm able to feed this pedal setup, I feed the Kemper, I feed the iPad, I feed the various guitar synth things, but they're all happening, they're all in parallel.
And you're changing in real time as you play, just depending on the song.
Yeah,
that's great. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow, wild, man.
It's super geeky and weird.
that's great. Like, that's great. How living color. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So these two are feeding these.
These.
The Kemper is going direct out.
The Kemper is actually going into the power. Basically, I'm using the power sections.
Oh, I get it. Okay. Right. So it's feeding. I get it. Yeah.
So if you check it out. It's geeky. There are two of these DODs in the back.
Oh, all right.
And so the ultimate output, the VG99 goes into this pedal setup. It goes out from the H9s into a left and right molt mix, kind of molt.
Yeah.
And the Kemper is going also in the left right of the molt. So they're kind of, it's pretty, it's bananas.
Yeah,
it's bananas.
That's great.
But it works well.
That's great. And so no direct signal, just running these as well.
I'm running it like that.
Mm-hmm. And tell me about this cool addition.
Oh man, this thing is really cool. David Coltai, who's associated with Pigtronics, has expanded his line to include the Supro amp line. And these are really, really great. Loud.
Right.
And really like, punchy sounding. Like they're using them as almost like a combo.
That's great. Like that Delta thing you're doing as you were just playing a minute ago, was that coming out of that?
That was actually coming out of those.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow. It's funny how you kind of...
But this right here is like where the...
That's
a little other thing going on over here.
Right, right. Yeah. That's great. So, and you just are going on and off, just switching between that and
like,
the others.
Yeah, like it's another layer of guitar sound effects, ambience, that I can bring in using various volume pedals. Using the volume pedal and the expression pedal controls the different effects. Like the echo, like Coltai comes out with this, but he also has made the Echolution too, and all the various, I have a Philosopher's Stone here.
Okay, well, hey, let's speed on that. Let's get into this pedal board business.
Yeah, yeah. Sure. So I have a few H9 by Eventide pedals in my setup. I have two, actually I'm running three of them, on these various boards. And this one has a crush station, which is a algorithm that adds distortion. Is that, they have the space and they have the various algorithms, and they just kind of came out with that, and that's actually very cool. Let's see if I can come up with something, one of those. Now that distortion is that's coming from the H9. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
That's like not a sound you would associate with an H9.
Yeah, or imagine from a Supro.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I have this thing right here by Source Audio. This is like their classic distortion. It's got various. It's very, very chunky. Anyway, there are various things that are cool. This is a flashback. It's a really nice delays. It's like a kind of comb filtering. Alien space sounds to annoy the neighbors.
Right, right.
This is a pedal by Catlin Bread. And it's kind of funny because it does this glitchy stuff. They can control what it does by moving the volume knob.
Oh, cool.
And this is very special because Nicholas, the president of the company, recently passed away, and it's kind of like...
Oh, I remember hearing about that. Yeah,
Guy, man, and great company, and it's really, really sad, but the company's gonna keep doing great products.
Yeah.
They're going to keep the legacy alive. So.
Yeah, well, that's great. That's great, really you cool. Still got them out there a little
bit.
Yeah. Yeah. And Philosopher's Stone, that's
Pigtronics. Philosopher's Stone, very cool. This Pigtronics is a very cool compressor thing. You can feel the sustain.
Yeah, that's great. Cool.
And
that's
you can get that to be kind of gritty as well.
Yeah.
And then there are these little Moore distortions, which are pretty wild, like this black one, the Black Secret, which is kind of like a rat. Oh, sorry.
No, it's fine. No worries.
Want to get really ratty with it?
Sure.
This is like a distortion plus. That's more like a distortion plus thing.
Yeah.
So that's
basically a.
That's a
traditional pedals.
Right, and that goes to the combo.
Okay. So that's just for the combo. Okay, cool.
That's just for the combo. Now, over here, these are the effects associated with the VG99.
Okay.
And this also there's an H9 on here, but there's also a pitch factor, which I still love that pedal. They're both made by Eventide. And there's an M9 Stompbox modeler.
Oh yeah, uh-huh. Of course.
That's been modified by Jack Vaughn. Hmm. He's a kind of pedal tweaker out of Atlanta, and his company is JHV3, and he does like kind of aftermarket things. He improves the headroom. Hmm. He cleans it up, the pedal up. He makes, you know, he has this very cool switches that he puts in.
Oh, very
cool.
Puts
a little roll bars, you know.
Yeah, that's very cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what a great box that is, right?
Yeah, it's really, yes. It's still. So I had a loop. I forgot I did that. Instant soundtrack.
Right, right. What a great. Is that all guitar on that loop?
Yeah, that's all. Yeah, that's
wow.
All that, and that's in the looper mode of this pedal. But of course, you know, it's also known for like all the different cool things.
Yeah.
Various delays and all different. Of course, all the different.
Oh, that's great.
All that kind of cool stuff, and then I also can use the looping function as you heard.
Yeah.
And then there's okay, now why aren't you doing what you're supposed to be doing? Oh.
Oh.
Yeah, like that.
That's great.
Uh-huh.
Right. So, okay, so that's that. And then over here in this madness.
And this is all the actual synthesizer type of things. So okay. This is like,
Wow.
Now this is actually kind of a older school thing. It's utilizing the 13 pin,
sure,
more of a traditional pitch to MIDI thing. But this here, that's an old GR20. This here is a SY300.
That's brand new, right?
That's brand new, and this you don't need a hex pickup for. There's a whole bunch of synthesis and synth emulations now that don't need a special pickup.
Cool.
So.
Wow, that's great.
And that's.
Wild.
And it tracks incredibly.
Oh, yeah. Now that runs just to your monitor, not to your amp.
Yeah, yeah. That's going DI.
Yeah.
It's very, very cool. When you get into it and you start working with it, you can do a lot of interesting things. Now, another thing that I've got going on is Electro-Harmonix has come out with a series of pedals, like the B9 and the C9, where you can, it's basically like a guitar organ, so you plug into it and you get the sound of an organ. They just came out with this Mel-9, and it gives you the sound of a Mellotron, and it's completely bonkers.
Oh, let's hear that. How crazy.
And that's just plugging straight in, and I don't know how they do it.
Wow.
It's polyphonic.
Wow.
It tracks really well.
Wow.
And I have this actually going into a Charles Bliss warped vinyl pedal. So it's
oh, that's great.
So if I want to go extra freaky, it's like, So now it sounds like it's off an old record. It's like,
yeah.
It's, dearly beloved, you know.
Yeah, right, right. That's great.
Isn't that cool? That is.
So these, are these running before the Boss?
Or? They're running, they're not, you know what? They're not running, the Boss is running by itself.
Okay.
Because I'm using this kind of molting concept. Where I'm able to take the guitar output and send it and molt it out to various sources. So it's not, it's by itself.
Oh, wow.
Right? This box right here is being fed by another one of these boxes, right?
Okay.
There's a box down there that's feeding this box, and it does it without adding artifacts or degradation.
Wow, that's
great. It's really
great.
Transparent. There's a couple of builders that you can find on Etsy that are also doing this. But Digitech, DOD, they came out with the original ones.
Wow, that's great.
And I found and I happened to find out about it by accident. I was in Boston in this guitar shop, and this guy was like had keyboards, but he had a bunch of keyboards going into like a Fender Twin, and they were like models, like a clavinet.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They weren't stereo stuff.
Yeah.
So they said, "Oh yeah, man, I use this thing, and it's cool because it's both a mixer and it's a multiplier."
Wow, that's
and
great.
That's how I'm able to do, you know. So the guitar coming is not going, like the guitar is feeding that, and that is different. They're the same, but they're different because so it's all going parallel.
Wow, it's something when you're building your rig. It's like such a creative process, and the ideas come from everywhere, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah. So you can kind of mess around and do all kinds of stuff. And the last thing is the Kemper. So the Kemper is,
yeah. Are you using any of the Kemper effects or?
I'm actually using the Kemper effects. These are pretty much, and that's the Kemper.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's all the straight Kemper, and it's got some pretty kind of rough, you know, like pretty raw, rough tones.
Wow.
You know, so it's like,
that's
so
awesome.
I'm able to kind of blend.
Right.
Blend things together, take things away, you know. So it's a very cool, it's a lot of freedom to kind of go with different places,
right?
You know,
so it's so cool. It just, you know, even your choice of picks, you switch it up on that.
Yeah. Well, this
right?
is, I'm a nut. I consider myself a plectrum fetishist.
Yeah,
like it's a bad, bad problem.
Get everything from like silver dollars.
Oh yeah, it's a Kennedy, the Kennedy half dollar.
Yeah,
and V picks. We're here in Nashville.
Oh yeah, right.
And I'm a big fan of Vinny's. V-picks.
Oh, right, right.
You know, these are very cool.
So these are
right here.
Stones,
so I have a few of these. I have a few crystal hearts. You
right.
know, you know, for some.
How do you even hold that, man?
Oh,
it is
because
so
I have,
thick.
Take it out, check out what I did. Take it out.
Oh, yeah. But still.
I put it.
easier, maybe, right. with that, but still.
So I put these pick. They're these kind of pick grip things you can stick on your picks so that. So that when you sweat, you don't lose control of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
It's really amazing. Like you have so many varieties of tones and options you're playing.
Yeah, it's pretty ridiculous, you know. And then there's and this.
That's my iPad.
Wow.
Right, and that's using the amplitude.
Right. Which is that part of line six, amplitude?
No, it's that's IK multimedia.
Okay.
Yeah, IK multimedia.
Yeah.
And this.
Yeah, so cool.
Using that with audio bus to combine various effects together.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Fabulous, man. Well, thanks for letting us inside the spaceship.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is.
Yeah, yeah, it's awesome. Well, man, you're an amazing talent. Gracious thank you for having us.
Thank you for having me. I mean, it's a lot of crap to go through. You know, Jeff deserves a statue in the park for putting this together every day.
Yeah, that's great.
The legendary Billy Cox, my mentor.
Oh man.
I don't think I'm gonna come. Yeah.
Billy!
Well. Yeah. Hey, Billy, you should do a cameo.
Would you mind?
Just walk in. Just walk hold in. This magazine for 1 second.
Cameo. Yeah.
My favorite guitar. Now, yeah. I like to introduce him.
Oh, please. A legend. Pleasure. Yeah. Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Legends on the man. They got all these crazy cameos and legends.
Now, I want you to zoom in on the man, the myth, and the legend right now, right here. This is my Uncle Bill, the original Billy Cox.
The original.
The man, the myth, and the legend, right here, live and in living color.
Hey.
All right? So whatever I did, he already did it twice before I got there.
But I'm gonna figure out what you did.
See, that's why I keep my uncle keeps me on my toes, because you notice as I started playing, he just appeared. Like all uncles do. That's why I love him so much.
Look here, my little cousin, my little nephew has a son. He's a preacher.
Okay.
And his wife's a school teacher, and they're decent, middle-class people. They don't use vulgar language or nothing. They got a little three-year-old kid, and he's sitting in the back. So a car backfires, says, bam! And he says, what the hell was that? So when I heard you, I said, what the hell? All right, introduce me to him.
Well, here's it. It is, Billy. Check it out.
See, we go without a name, and we go. You stay there.
I'm going to give him my own private lesson.
Give you a lot of stuff.
This might even be better than what you want, right? You might as well get the camera over here right now and get some of this.
Right, what is it she got, man?
I'm explaining to him right now.
Okay, exactly. Please,
yes.
You guys zoomed in?
Okay.
Because we can kill two birds with one stone. So, okay. Billy, what I got going on, first of all, I got nothing but love for you.
Okay, go
ahead. That's bigger than anything else.
That's
right
bigger
now.
Than
now, starting off from here, basically what I do is I have all of this is all sequenced together so that all the tones are all matched up.
Okay.
That means this. My signal path starts here with the sans amp.
Okay, I got one of those.
You got one of those, okay. Right? From the sans amp, I loop it back around to the distortion, right?
I don't have one.
And now the distortion, this is a good distortion because I can hit all of the buttons on.
Okay.
Do you hear anything? You hear any hiss or
None.
Any scream? Do you hear any shh?
No hiss.
None of that. So that's full on, right?
All right, all right.
So now that pedal goes into that. Now I hook that into a nice old Dan Electro pedal.
Okay.
Where you will hear, you hear that?
A lot of screeching.
So that's got the screechiness in it. For that kind of vibe. Out of there, we circle around, now I go into the bendy pedals.
Bendy pedals,
bendy
okay.
pedals, meaning starting with my whammy pedal, which is one of my favorite pedals.
All right.
This was introduced to me by Joe Satriani.
Satriani.
I was doing his record okay. with a, so, and I like
man.
This, I like this because I can go, I can do like stuff like. Stuff like that. Now the whole thing about this is I get to do body movement.
Uh-huh.
So you know how you had those drummers
uh-huh.
that we all like to play with. Now there's nothing better than playing with a drummer that gives you the body movement, right?
Right,
you
right,
know,
right.
The shoulders and stuff. So that enables me to get a little aerobics
okay,
going
I
on
guess, okay.
while I'm playing that. Followed by the wah-wah pedal, okay. which is, you know. So all of these are going like again.
Voodoo
my noisy, right. my noisy pedals here give me some distortion, whammy into the wah-wah,
okay.
right?
Uh-huh.
So now, from that point, we shift over and we go from that into a flanger. Which my good tech Jeff will be fixing one of these cables.
Uh-huh.
So you can actually see nothing better than seeing stuff in real time. And I'm quite sure all you folks watching this always see everything already nice and butted up. But this is what happens in real time when you're at a sound check. You hear cable noise.
But, man, that's nice.
But these pedals know I will whoop their butt if they don't have the stuff ready right about now. It's embarrassing me in front of this camera. Anyway, so we go from that into now the envelope filters. Now,
envelope filter.
And all of these are like, all of these pedals are like mainly guitar pedals.
Okay.
They're none of them except for the Sansa. And they're all discontinued. This is a great one. This is an envelope filter,
okay.
FX25.
Yeah.
It gives you... The other thing that's really good is when you want to play... When you don't want to have it, the envelope go all the way open like that. Just play really light, you get a reggae sound.
I like that.
See what I'm saying? So now you just play light, and now you got two for one. So I like that because no other envelope filter gives me that sensitivity
okay.
where I can go down from. I'm giving y'all all, it's not secrets, because they ain't going to do me no good when I leave here. It's just fact of how I. Great $25 pedal if you can get it online. They discontinued it. Now, here's the one that everybody likes. This is like when I go to a club, I ask the club owners, are you guys trying to get a new PA system? Have you insurance? Okay. Do you want me to blow the stuff up now, later, or during the show so you can prove? This pedal will blow your stuff up. This is an old synth wah. So that's that. That's really, really good. This is scares people. And then I got a ringworm.
Which one does that?
You see what I'm saying?
Which one does
this?
Is
Lauryn Hill's favorite pedal.
Lauryn Hill pedal, okay.
Lauryn Hill loves this pedal right here when I was working with her.
I think I got one in gray like that.
The synth wash. She can play it on any ballad. Doug, give me that. What's that big pedal you got? Makes that big loud noise. When we're playing a ballad, I want it to sound big. She loves that pedal. Love her. Anyway, now I got the ringworm, which is. Now that's good. Now the thing is that, like I said, they all go in conjunction with each other. And I'm gonna show you how that works.
Okay.
Another one I have is my little secret weapon.
Uh-oh.
Even though it says it's a super drive, it's actually an old digital delay sampler pedal. It only samples like about 800 milliseconds. And what I do with that is I drop dive bomb.
Whoa.
I'll do that now. So that one, that's how I drop the dive bomb. So we're going. Stuff like that.
Great.
You know what I mean? So that gives you another. Now I have somebody else to start smacking me when I want to, like, when Will's doing the double bass drum pedal, I might can get a little note in between the raindrops. You know what I mean? So I can add to that. Billy, this is dope. Now, again, they all work in conjunction with each other. Let me show you how that goes down.
Okay.
I got another digital delay pedal, DD3, but I use this mainly for the hold function. What that hold function is, you can hit a note and it holds it. And it's all how you play it. Because the whole thing is, it's just a matter of like, it's like shock and awe. So you're playing. Just kind of like tether back and forth. Now, here's the fun part. Even before I get to the next layer, which I will, I'll work my way down. Now, here's my some of my favorite pedals that are new pedals that I love. If I could have a pedal board full of all of these, I would. That's these H9s by Eventide.
Okay.
And these pedals are monstrously good. They have so many different sounds in it, from like I could do something like. Nice little swirly sound. Now, if I go like this, I can get like a gated reverb sound. And then that in conjunction with something, with a great thing that was created 8 years ago called glass, you know, I get to do. Again, it's touch sensitive. It's just the shape of the note I'm going for, really. It's not. It's just noise, really. I don't know if they got that notation in Berklee College of Music yet, but we'll figure it all out later on.
All right.
Now, but some of the other things that's good about this, got great, great sounds, one of which is this one. You really want to freak people out? You're doing a song, do the finale. Can you drop this one? When I do movie soundtracks, they like that pedal. That's the that's my Hollywood swinging pedal. I call that Hollywood swinging, because that's what they like for the sound effects, and so on and so forth. And I write songs like I was doing earlier. I like to do little song. And so forth. Uh-huh. I don't want to get too greedy here. Now, here's the fun part. Another thing that's good is I have a slicer pedal, which takes the sound and just gives you pulse. And you can, it just chops it up. So like when you're playing, if you know, like you take a straight note, and you can start to get it synced up to tempo of what the drummer's doing. So for example, I could tap the tempo in here, or I can go faster. Slower, faster, so you tap tempo. Now here's where it gets fun. Now you start adding other pedals that are prior to that pedal, like the ringworm, then it really comes alive. So now is when the synth mind comes into play. How do I start to match up other effects to slice it up? You know what I mean? And then make it all work quick. Because that's the key. How quick can you get in and out of something? So I might be doing something. Sometimes you can even go like this. Now I'll do it again, but I'll add the Eventide with it. Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
That is,
that's incredible.
You know, and it's all coming, and you know, the whole thing is, man, never let a person tell you what you can't do. I learned it from him. I studied a lot of stuff. I'm a Hendrix baby, all right? So I'm blessed to be next to my mentor right here. And the whole vibe of what they, in my opinion, They paved the road for, don't listen to nobody telling you what you can't do. There's a lot of musical police officers out here in this music business, and they'll be your best friend telling you what not to do. No, man, we're gonna play rock and roll. No, we're gonna play this. You play whatever you wanna do. He's living proof. And we all believe me. I'm not the architect of this, I'm the recipient by listening. And if you listen, you can learn. And that's it. So on the other note, pretty much the other stuff that I got is another couple of H. Now, here's another cool thing. Yo, Billy, this is dope. Check this out. When there ain't no drummer here, now you got one.
Beat bud.
Dude, talking about hot, this is hot. This is my favorite joint right now because I can practice without a drummer.
Okay.
And then you can stop it. You can change it. Now, that's just that, but check out some of the other amazing other, like metal, for example. Check this out. They got it down, too. Jeff, this is right up your alley. This is my favorite pedal right now for just practicing. Yeah. Crazy. Anyway, you get an idea of like how much fun it is to have a drummer there for your timing, right, when you're practicing. Excellent to have something like that in your arsenal. But at the end of the day, I'm the effect. Take all of this stuff away. I don't need any of it, man. I just put the bass up, play it. I don't need. I'm old school. I grew up playing a Fender jazz bass and just, you know, whatever instrument somebody put in my hand, I just was happy to have it and play it. And then when I had the money, I bought an instrument. But I borrowed instruments from all my friends at first who had parents that were able to buy them instruments.
So Billy, just by comparison, what's your rig like during all the Hendrix stuff?
Marshalls. A band, dry. Yeah, every now and then a fuzz. Yeah. That's it.
Right?
Yeah.
In the fingers.
And the fingers.
Yeah.
But you know what? He made Jimmy one of his first cables. Was that right? Or the long cable?
Oh, really?
Yeah, I made it 100 feet long and I lost 1/1000th of a second. I cut it up, I finally wound up about 62, 63 inches, and that did it. But he couldn't go to the door of the club, you know, so he had to do his power techniques and jive, you know, from halfway through the club. But he used to go outside with it, but he lost 1/1000th of a second.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
That's the man.
That's one story.
Yeah. Well, we got to do your rig right now.
Yo, you got to get him down. No, I'm fine. Get him down. You could put him down now.
I'm trying to find him. You see the rest of the story.
Okay, great. I'll watch it all.
All right.
Now, that's a great cameo, Billy Cox.
Hey, man.
Come on.
You can't plan. Hey, we planned this. By God planned this. You know what I mean?
Right.
But yo,
down here, I'll give you $20.
And food stamps and government cheese. Those sandwiches are good. But
fabulous. That's amazing. Hey, can you tell us a little bit about your basses as well?
Well, the basses I got, gentlemen, are Spector basses.
Sure. And you've been playing this since '86.
This one I got in 1987.
Wow.
I got this.
There's high miles on that.
You know what happened is this, man. You spend your whole life coming up. You try to do stuff. You play with certain bands. It's not till you get put on playing with somebody famous, then everybody wants to know who you are.
And it's Jeff Beck.
You know what
right?
I mean? Jeff Beck was that gateway for me. Right. You know what I mean? Because once I played with Jeff Beck, hey, Doug, how you doing? Hey, come on over. You mind? Okay. Now, prior to that, I couldn't get any mint-flavored toothpicks in the restaurant. You know what I mean? But that's the nature of the business that we're in. Right. So remember, believe in everybody, not just the elite that you see all the time. I'm your classic underdog. You ain't gonna see me on. Maybe you'll see me on the cover of these magazines, but not many more. I'm probably making a repeat on here before I got on any of the other ones. But it's all good because I play from the heart, and I'm not a music whore. I'm not like some cat that's just trying to get gear to play it and go to NAMM and pick stuff up. I play it because I like it, and I'd rather pay for it so that there's no other stuff going on the side if that happens. So that's how I deal with it.
Well, what you
Spector bass, 1987. Backstory of this was I happened my guitar tech at the time, Pierre de Beaupart, who now techs, he's really good. He works with Keith Richards now. I'm dropping names, but I've got Billy here, so I can't get nothing bigger than him. But anyway, he introduced me to the guys over at Kramer. And at that time, Kramer had acquired Spector. I was a fan of Spector basses. The bass player in the group called Cameo, a bass player named Aaron Mills, was the first person I saw use a Spector bass when I was out on the road with the Sugar Hill Gang in 1979. We became friends. His bass was made in Brooklyn, and I always had my eye on it, but my wallet did not have my eye on. My wallet was, it ran away every time I looked trying to buy that bass. Gone. And then I had the opportunity to get one, and what happened was when Stuart Spector was somebody's interested in getting to use one of his products, he had a loaner bass. So I got the loaner bass. It was a black bass. It went to everybody. So if you get the loaner bass, play it. If you liked it, then they made a bass for you. But you gave the loaner bass back.
Right.
That's how that went down. So the necks were too thick for me personally, and I'm a jazz bass player, like Uncle Billy. So I had him shave the neck down real thin. It's Doug Wimbish profile. Look at that. Look at that. Look at all those collard greens taking off that neck right there. So I had him shave it down. And I had him shave the body down smaller as well. It wasn't intentional, it was just that we just happened to be at the moment at the time. And Stuart kept saying, I don't know, Doug, if it's gonna work. I'm like, I felt like Scotty on Star Trek. Push it a little bit longer, Captain. We'll get the dilithium crystals. I can't go any farther. But he did. And I got this bass, and this now I was blessed to have it. That's numero uno. Then followed by, I needed a fifth string, and I never had one before. I had one, but it wasn't that. Wasn't that great? So then I happened to catch him at the right time again. He was just starting to make five string basses, that year. So I managed to get this five string bass from him. Same vibe, I think I had him shave it down a little bit because these bodies are different. And these two have been my go-to bass. That's the color of it now. This is the color of it when I got it.
Wow, High Miles.
High Miles.
Yeah.
The neck was all blue. As you can see, this has got some Battlestar Galactica stuff going on. But between a great guitar player and his band Sworn Enemy and Jeff, he looks after me. He's here. He's on loan from the community, but he looks after me and tightens it up. And Jimmy and all the guys over at Spector, I kind of take it up there for its shape up and every now and then. But these are my go-to basses. These are the ones that I kind of been using over the last
year. These two.
These are the ones I tour with, and everybody, and I'm glad that they're still here, and I'm still here to do it because I'm really happy with them.
Oh, they sound fabulous. And your amps.
Oh, one other thing is, okay. I always want to make sure that we got the Pigtronics in there, but a good friend of mine, Dave Kotai, came up with this Pigtronics Infinity pedal, which is immaculate. It's great. So, and it's funny because they're all my mates. It's not like, Be careful of the choices you make. Everybody all the gear I'm using right now, they're all my mates now. The guys from Eventide are good, not just, we're good friends. We hang out, we do a lot of things together, as is Dave Kotai. They were, those are the guys that are like really coming up with really good stuff, and they're the last of the Mohegans that are still there for you. A lot of guys have, there's been a lot of revolving doors in some of these companies, and guys come and go, but I'm happy to know that I'm still friends with Stuart. I'm still using Trace Elliott amplifiers from back in the day, and most of these pedals are people that I know.
That's great. And these two amps, you're running, are you running a stereo rig between
I'm running
the two?
A stereo rig.
It's big, man. That
The thing is just like two heads are better than one. You never know, something goes wrong. So you're sitting there going, oh, what am I going to do? You have to do the rest of the gig without it. So I've learned over the years, two things, always have two of everything. If you can do, because anything that you think won't happen, basically is waiting to happen, and so that's kind of how my, it takes a bit of a You know, it's a lot, but when you're, yo, dude, man, when you're going to battle and everybody else got Uzis and you roll up with a Cub Scout knife, you are going to lose. Does that make any sense? Yeah, you are not going to win. So you try to make sure when you're on the road that you have as much possibilities of having some backup, even if it's your bass, your extra strings, batteries. It's the little things that can take you down, your cable. And speaking of cables, one of the key reasons why my pedals are quite quiet is I've been able to use Larry Fishman introduced me to these, what are these?
Astrobe cables, yeah.
Yeah, they're really good.
They're great.
They use these like, and I was—
directional too.
Yeah, they're very good, they're very clean. They're almost like little instruments themselves. So I've used those, and then prior to that, I was using Monster cables and everybody. So I use everybody's stuff, man. I'm not like one, like, I'm afraid to mention this one and not the other. I with all due respect, everybody gets a mention because every piece of gear that I use was, and still is, it's part of my learning experience. I learn from what I'm using, and then you see something else, and you realize, okay, well, this can maybe work better for me, maybe just because the barrel heads are smaller or bigger. But at the end of the day, everything that you see here is stuff that I've been dreaming to have, and I found a way how to, over the years, figure out the right chain and figure out the science that goes behind the settings and everything. And I'm using EMG pickups in my basses, which really gives me the capability of keeping things clean and clear. And I'm using Rotosound strings. Again, these are guys that I've known for years and years and years. And Jimmy used Rotosounds, right? Probably subconsciously or realistically, the reason why I'm using it is because of the sound that I heard Jimmy getting on and what those cats were doing. But for the most part, that's pretty much it. I'm also using Keith McMillan's soft step and 12-step pedals to trigger sounds and samples off of on the floor. And I'm using his Q-Neo pads, and I love Keith's stuff because it's you can do quite a lot of stuff with one pad. You can get five different sounds coming out and stuff like that. But again, you know, it's no good unless it's musical. You can have all this gear and do nothing. Sit there and set up and it doesn't work. And you get there and it just, take that out, plug me straight in. There's nothing better than having a unit to be able to explore with. Living Color is a great unit for that. Prior to that, there's been many other bands. Tackhead, the band that I was in England, and we were one of the first bands to do a lot of sampling and stuff like that. Adrian Sherwood, Keith LeBlanc, Skip McDonald. Then prior to that, I did all the Sugar Hill Records stuff, all of the Sugar Hill
stuff. So with that, were you just jazz bass straight into a...
Sugar Hill era was my Fender jazz bass straight in. And I'll never forget, the biggest thing that happened for me was DiMarzio pickups came out, and I put those in there, and I think that was one of the biggest mistakes I made because I didn't realize that the original ones that I had in there were really the it. You know what I mean? So then later on, I kind of went back on, oh, this kind of feels good, but then I managed to go back, and I ran into a friend named Robert Johnson, who is actually not the Robert Johnson, the blues player, but this Robert Johnson is from Memphis, Tennessee. He used to play guitar with Isaac Hayes. You know Robert? He has Flying Mojo pickups. So the short end of it is, he basically ran into a person that had vats full of the, he used to work at Fender, and this guy had vats full of the original magnets and components.
Oh.
Found the guy, started a company. So when I met him, he saw my collection of basses, and I had my Fenders. He was like, yo, you're not gonna believe this, but I got some of the original pickups. Would you mind me retrofitting my pickups in there? I was like, yeah, why not? So. So I'm using his pickups on my original jazz basses, on my, let's just say the active basses are EMGs that's going in there. So it's still the best of both worlds. Listen, man, there's nothing better than picking up the instrument that you know, that you played, like a Fender Jazz, and it just, how are you gonna define how good that sounds? You can't, you know what I mean? So it's like, they're like, Any of these basses, when my Fender Jazz comes up, it gets a hall pass. You know what I mean? Doesn't matter what else is going on. So even Stuart and everybody's, oh yeah, oh Doug, yeah, come here, let me clean it up. And stuff. But that's just how it is. But if you keep a good relationship with your friends and your companies, then you'll always sleep good at night. Because the worst thing you could do is back in the day, Billy will tell you, back in the real hardcore endorsement days, when if somebody saw you, they gave you a guitar and you weren't using that guitar, believe me, there was a hit on you. you were getting, something bad was going to happen to you. No, I'm only kidding, but these things did get personal, and if I just keep it professional. I keep the personal stuff out of it and keep it professional. So all you kids listening, Come here, Billy. I want y'all to look. This is the architect. I'm the recipient.
Hey.
And that's how we go down. That's how it goes down. Is that it?
That
peace and love.
That's a good out, Billy Cox. Yeah. what a great cameo. Yeah. Doug, thank you so much, man.
You're more than welcome, man.
That was a pleasure.
Hey, yeah. It's all good. Quick, fast, and in a hurry.
Yeah.
Thank you, Billy.
Here. Yeah. Always,
hey, let me give you this money here right now.
Till next time.
Don't forget to sign up for PG Perks, your all-access pass to exclusive gear giveaways and discounts on PremierGuitar.com.